So yeah, next up, you know, again in our invitation letters, we spoke of it being a very piquant session because we've been speaking of very large themes of communalism and survival and triumph and all of that. But Soha Ali Khan's book is really about something even more quintessential, which is the self. And the self is a very inexplicable thing because it has absolutely no relation to either success or accomplishment or gifts or indeed even the approval of others. Right here at home, we've had, you know, people as beautiful and accomplished and successful as Deepika Padukone coming out in public saying that, you know, she's had a period of acute depression. You know, we've had Karan Johar come to us at Algebra speaking about how he went through a period of acute depression, self-doubt, you know, went to a counselor. Of course, across the oceans, you have somebody who thinks of himself as a stable genius. You know, even as he threatens to press the nuke and play big boy games with North Korea. And you have someone like Robin Williams who committed suicide. And all of that really is to say that the self is an inexplicable being. So Soha Ali Khan's book is to explore that really piquant situation of what does the self mean when you are moderately famous, but you're the son, now I've really complicated yourself, but when you happen to be the daughter of, I didn't say that. When you're the daughter of Mansoor Ali Khan Pataudi and Sharmila Tagore, and you're the sister of Saif Ali Khan and the sister-in-law of Kareena Kapoor, this is a tongue-twisting identity. So to really explore, how do you come out of that jungle, that circus, that blizzard of possible obliteration and really find who you are? And I think that is what really triggered Soha Ali Khan to write this memoir. It's a lovely, you know, it's a kind of textural memoir, deprecatory, self-deprecatory, ironic, also loving. And we're going to press all those buttons to find really how deep does that loving go before the split self kicks in. And so, ladies and gentlemen, to walk this very piquant journey of self-discovery and really embracing the self for who you are, we very naughtily called the session Embrace Your UID, your unique identity, and I'll leave the D part of it out for now. So ladies and gentlemen, to discuss the self, all ourselves, please welcome Soha Ali Khan.
Thank you so
much. Thank you. So before we even begin to start on all of this, you've obliterated another identity already. You're a newborn mother. How do you get to look like this, you know?
God, you know, I have to say that it's probably because I've been so stressed for the past few weeks. I am a new mother, and I can see a lot of possible mothers out there. And it's tough work. It's very challenging. And I'm the youngest in my family, so I've never grown up around children. Everyone's always looked after me. So this is the first time I'm looking after this live human being, and I'm responsible for keeping her alive. And it's very scary.
Do you want to turn back the clock and become an autonomous being?
No, she can't hear me. No, I don't, but there are times, you know. I think all new mothers become they become bipolar very quickly. You know, you wake up in the morning and you're full of positivity and I can do this. And for many, many days, I would go to sleep crying, saying, I don't know what I'm doing. But, you know, it's getting better now.
So,
I am better now.
So let me start, you know, before we arrive and explore how you arrived at the comfortable selfhood that you very clearly have arrived at, let's first talk about all the obliterations, you know. So you, of course, we've already described your genealogy, but you also went to Oxford, you studied history, you had a boyfriend who brushed you off by saying that you don't buy the first house that you spot, you know, and all of that. So could you run the audience through some of the really worst plot points in the obliteration of Soha Ali Khan, you know?
Well, I mean, to explain the boyfriend part, it was, you know, of course, as a young girl, when you're 15, 16, you're very romantic, and I wanted to marry, you know, the person that I was seeing at that point. And I thought that when school ended and we went our separate ways and he went off to America to study and I went to England, that of course we would keep it going long distance. But he wrote me a letter and he sent it home to me because I don't think he wanted to tell me face to face. And he said, you know, relationships are like buying a house and you don't buy the first one you see. And you look around a little bit, and if that means that, you know, that was your dream house, the first house, and you miss out, well, that's a risk you have to take. And I thought, wow, that's hugely unromantic. And I have to say that I moved on before he did. I must put that in. But that was one of the lessons. You know, it's been a lot of people ask me, of course, since I've chosen to work in the same industry as my mother and my brother. It's a choice that I made. And I understood that when I did that, I would be opening myself up to a lot. I think now it's been 12, 13 years, and people have understood perhaps a little bit that I have my own identity, I'm trying to do my own thing. And as you said, maybe that's why I wanted to write the book, because I feel like a lot of people have an idea of who you are. And I wanted somewhere to get to know people in the way that you do through social media. I wanted to tell my story in some way such that perhaps we can clear up some of those misconceptions.
So as I said, so we're going to come to the arrival later, you know. First, just to really talk about, you're quite breezy in the book. It's funny, you know, you're self-deprecatory, you're ironic about a lot of the times. But do open up and share with us that really, how difficult was it? You know, were you resentful? Were you angry at any point? Share with us some of the really down moments of being part of this family of the illustrious, you know?
You know, I'm trying to think of down moments, and I think, and I don't know when, I've always been very accepting of who I am. And I'd like to think it comes from a place of security, and maybe it's from having a stable family background, maybe it's from studying in England, or going to a small school here in Chanakyapuri in Delhi, where people just made friends with you for who you were, as opposed to who your parents were. Honestly, growing up, I had no idea who my parents were beyond them being Amma and Abba. You know, like my mother told this story as well, when someone asked at a school interview and they said, what do your parents do? I was very young at the time. And of course I said, well, you know, Amma is Amma and Abba is Abba. And I had no idea until I went to Oxford and I learned about my father's achievements. And when I joined the film industry, I learned about my mother's achievements. So I think that to answer your question, of course there have been times, not growing up, but in a later stage when I've been frustrated by the fact that, you know, no matter how hard I try, it'll be difficult to match up to what my parents have achieved or what my brother has achieved. And there's an expectation, not from within the family, but I think from outside, when you follow in the path of success, to be equally successful. And when you don't meet that expectation, then it can be difficult, even when you're not trying to. But other people seem to think that that's something that you should do, especially when you join that industry. And I think that's when I made it difficult for myself. If I had done something else, it would have been all right. But when I chose to be an actor, and most people, when you are the son or daughter of an actor and a cricketer, they expect you're going to either be a cricketer or an actor, like there's no other option, which is why I rebelled strongly and thought I want to do something else. And I tried to be a banker, and that lasted about 15 months. And then I worked with the Ford Foundation, which I really enjoyed, for 2 years. But if I think a part of you wants to act, it's quickly sort of, you know, subsumes the rest of you. And so I thought, let me try this, you know, knowing full well what was coming. And of course, then I was hit with a lot.
So, you know, again, as I said, we'll talk to about how you worked through all of this. But you describe it very funnily, you know, that first meltdown. Actually, you had two quick meltdowns when you first joined the movies. One, you were offered a film that was quickly withdrawn. And then the second, where you actually did the film Dil Maange More, and the reviews and your reaction. And, you know, I won't say more. Why don't you share those two episodes with the audience, you know?
I thought the reason I joined films was because I was offered a beautiful script about a wonderful folk tale, and it was a romantic role. Two young actors were going to be launched, myself and another unknown young man. Amol Palika was to direct the film. And I quit my job at Citigroup. I was about to be transferred to England, and I was supposed to have this wonderful life, which was transparent and easy for my parents to understand, especially my father, who didn't follow films at all. And I knew that this was something he wanted me to do. And as any young girl, I wanted to make my father proud. And so I was on that career path when this script landed up on my doorstep. And I, of course, immediately quit my job and gave myself to this. And as soon as I made that decision to join this unpredictable world of films, I got a call from Amol Palika saying, oh, there's been a change in plans. And instead of launching two new people in the film, I'm actually going to work with Shah Rukh Khan in the role. This is a film called Paheli.
And Rani Mukherjee.
Yes, I of course didn't understand that that meant that I was also being chucked out. I thought, oh, that's great. And he's like, no, no, that means that you are also not going to be in the film. And I said, oh, that's not so great. I don't have a job. I don't have any money. And I'm living, you know, in a sort of one BHK in Lokhandwala, and I have to pay 17,000 rupees rent. And my parents aren't speaking to me because I've quit my job. So I think that is why I signed Dil Maange More, which I'm sure none of you have seen. And this is not an invitation to see it. Please don't. But I'd like to think that, thank you. It's not that bad also. But I didn't understand at that point that the dynamics of films, because I'd just come back from England. I thought that acting in Hindi movies was about acting as an interesting character. So when I was offered Dil Maange More, there were three girls in the film, and I didn't think that was a big deal. I thought I wanted to play the most interesting character, which was a young girl who chose her career over her boyfriend at the time. And I thought that makes sense because she's only 19, and that's something I would do. So that's the role that I chose. And I realized that I was giving up the role of the heroine, because obviously, by definition, the heroine is the girl who ends up with Shahid Kapoor in the film. So I'd shot myself in the foot. So these were things that were quickly explained to me later. When the review came out, it said in a newspaper that everyone gets, I'm sure, it said, she looks like her mother, but she acts like her father. Which, you know, again, my father was confused by it, because, you know, I don't think the reviewer meant it as a compliment, but he was like, well, has she not seen, you know, Gwalior suiting ads? But yes, it wasn't a compliment. So for someone who's, you know, done very well, and, you know, I'd just come back from Oxford, and, you know, I thought I was doing very well, it was mortifying to, you know, and as you know, it's a very public review. It's not like your report cards in school.
No, but the misery doesn't end there, right? So there's just, you have to come on, give the finale, you know, the end. You've forgotten your own finale, you know. So that you curled up in bed with...
Oh, that, all of that. Yeah, that of course. I mean, yes, of course. So it was mortifying. And as one would do, I didn't leave the house for 2 days. And I got into my pajamas and, you know, this was the age of DVDs. And I watched Sex and the City back to back for 2 days and ate a whole tub of ice cream. And I was just like, I cannot make eye contact with anyone ever again, because I'm such a failure. And again, like, how will I face my parents? How will I face anyone? And it was, I think, 12 hours later that, you know, and many thousands of calories later, that my brother called and said, let's go out for dinner. And I said, no, I can't. And my film is a disaster. And, you know, I can't go anywhere. And he said, you know, today's review lines tomorrow's waste paper basket, and it really doesn't matter. And you're giving this far more importance than anyone else. Nobody else is thinking about you right now. Only you are thinking about yourself. So just, you know, put on your dress and come out, and tomorrow's a new day. And that helped me.
So let me give the punchline, since, you know, there was a punchline even beyond this, which was that finally, after she'd kept herself in isolation, in hiding, imagining the whole world was, you know, discussing the failure of Soha Ali Khan, she picked up the phone thinking there was going to be a barrage of phone calls. And there was one from her driver, missed call, and one from Vodafone saying, pay your bill.
That's true. I obviously haven't read my book in a while.
See, I took your identity very seriously, Soha. So, yeah. And, you know, there are many, but what intrigued me, Soha, was that, you know, you've got a history from Oxford. There's, you know, you're clearly very well read. There are just like hints of that. There's, of course, the Mercator analogy to Bollywood self-obsession, which, again, I'd like you to share with the audience. But why don't you reveal more of all of that in the book, you know? You say finally that I finally understood who I am. Will you share with us who you are, you know? Because it doesn't come through in the book, actually.
No, well, I'm always too scared of, of boring people. I always, you know, that's why I try and keep things as short as possible. And it's not a long book, you know, it's very breezy. I'm always, again, when I speak, I'm always trying to, I don't see people who are impatient, who want to go home. So that's just who I am. I'm also very reserved, I think. I'm friendly and chatty, but my friends say that, you know, we've known you for years. And only after reading the book, even Kunal, who I've known for 10 years, said, I've learned so much about you after reading this book that I didn't know. And I think it's because I forgot at some point that, you know, It's a conversation, you know, that took place at mainly 2 a.m. between myself and my laptop. And I forgot that other people are going to ultimately be privy to this conversation. And I think that's why I did let go. And this is as much as I can let go, you know, and this is as much as I can reveal of myself, I think. And it was tough to even say this much. So I'm surprised you say that I haven't. But I think that if me, I am what you see is what you get, I think. I like who I am. I'd like to think that, you know, I am a product of a number of things. A lot of people say that I'm a lot like my father in terms of temperament. I'm as cool as a cucumber. I don't lose my temper ever, ever, really. Except for Kunal, who manages to infuriate me at times. If I'm very hungry. I am loyal. I'm a loyal person, I think. What else? I don't take myself very seriously, but a lot of people have talked about this book as it being self-deprecating. I think beyond that, it's just about being accepting of who you are. And sometimes, that, you know, I would think about whether I'm coming across as too hard on myself. You know, I'd read the book and I would find that I've reached a roadblock and for some reason I can't write anymore, especially with the work chapter, which I struggled with. And I realized why that was. It was because I was being too self-deprecating and I was being too hard on myself. And at some point, I think you need to step back and say, you know, it's all right. Not everybody can be a superstar. Not everybody needs to be. And, you know, being famous is also not something I value beyond a point. It's not actually that important. And it's, you know, can be overrated. And life is short. You must enjoy yourself. So if you're going to be so stressed all the time about all your achievements and, you know, where you need to get, then you won't enjoy where you are.
So did you go through any phase in your life when you weren't this comfortable? Because if you've been this comfortable, then why explore it in a book?
Well, I've always wanted to write a book, and I was just daunted by the fact that, you know, it's 40,000 words, and, you know, who'll be interested, and what, you know, lots of silly things. Of course, there were times when, you know, I think again, when I went to England, when I went to Oxford, I was scared about that because I had an impression about how studious everyone would be, and, you know, I had this impression of everyone wearing big, thick glasses and walking around with piles of books, and whether I would fit in, and I would, you know, I'd done very well in my A levels, but that was again being, you know, surrounded by people where I'd always topped the class. Here I was going to be in a class of people where they'd all topped the class, and where would I, you know, fit in and all of that. So I've had many moments of self-doubt. Again, some of the times you struggle with that and you have sleepless nights and you do, of course, question yourself. But I think that I have always been who I am, you know, to answer your question. And the book has just been, you know, something that I had the time to do because I was pregnant and not doing a lot. I was sitting at home and I thought this is a good time to write all of that down because it's important to chronicle things before you forget them as well. And a lot of the book, again, especially the opening chapter, is about my past and about my parents and about my grandparents. And, you know, and, of course, you know, none of my grandparents are alive now, but my maternal grandmother, I'm glad she put herself on tape. Otherwise, I wouldn't have been able to tell her story, which I've told a little bit in the book. So I thought before I forget, I must write it down.
So what about Bollywood, you know, and we'll come back to that marketer analogy, but, you know, you got a break with Rang De Basanti and you did very well in that and, you know, your role was acclaimed. That after Rang De Basanti and the acclaim that you got, why would you feel, you know, do you think you kind of self-exuded the anxiety of coming from this family? Why would your cinema career not take off at the pitch that Rang De Basanti indicated that it could, you know, and it's, so what, when you self-analyze that, why has that happened?
I would say that, one doesn't have that much control over their career. So it's not like, I mean, you have these plans and, you know, if you could say, oh, I'd be a part of this film and that film, and you don't know that they're going to work, but if they're presumably worked, then your career can, at any Friday, take a turn for the better or for the worse. So I'm certainly not in control of my career in films. Of course, there are certain choices that you can make, but those choices are limited to what is offered to you. And you are very rarely offered a film like Rang De Basanti. It was my third film. It wasn't even my first film, perhaps if it had been my launch film, because it took me some time to dig myself out of Dil Maange More as well. You know, that came out, it wasn't well received, then you have to start again, and you don't get many chances. You know, even though we talk about the N-word, nepotism, you get a foot in the door, But you, and I'm living example of that, you know, I did get a foot in the door, but it wasn't even such a great door, and, you know, it wasn't even, you know, and that was, you know, I tried to do everything myself, and, you know, so it all went horribly wrong. So it, and by Rang De Basanti, it was wonderful. I dug myself out a little bit, and then you make choices, and I've always thought that I want to be a part of certain films because of the people, the story, you know, what feels right at the time. Some of them work, some of them don't work, and...
So, you know, Ashishtha earlier spoke about this phenomenon where you are constantly constructing yourself in relation to someone else. In your case, it's like taken to the extreme, and you have a really funny passage in the book, All Roads Lead to Saifina, you know. Maybe you could read that out for people to get a sense of just what you've suffered, you know. And I'm going to then reprobe you about how you've arrived at equanimity, because you're not giving us enough of that. You
know? There is a chapter called All Roads Lead to Saifina. And it's really about what I have to deal with. And I think you'll sympathize. Should I read the chapter? It's not very long at all. And I read fast.
So, I, you know, the untrained psychologist in me can see a lot that I'm going to probe, you know. Uh-oh. I read fast. I'm not going to take long.
Yeah.
Low self-esteem.
Oh, God, I don't know. It's good to be in tune with your audience, though. No, it's better to... Anyway. I was still lying in bed, scrolling through my Twitter feed, sipping coffee, more asleep than awake, when I saw the headline. Soha reveals major secret about Kareena Kapoor Khan's pregnancy. What? When? Where? Who? I couldn't answer any of the four basic questions journalists are taught to ask, but I was already panicking. The coffee had turned to mud in my mouth, and I was finding it difficult to breathe. I'm usually so careful. I never say anything about Amma, Bhai, and Kareena, and especially nothing about the baby. Had I inadvertently let something slip? I sat up and scanned the rest of the article, and the more I read, the more I relaxed. The major secret was that Bhai and Kareena, or Saifina, as they are together referred to, were not planning to have their child in London, as far as I knew. I remembered the interview. I remember answering the obligatory question about how I was feeling about becoming a bua, dismissing the one about what preparations we were making, expressing vitriol over the one about whether I wanted a girl or boy for them. Will they have the baby in London? The question had come out of the blue, and I was bemused. Why would they have the baby in London? There was some furious scribbling and a furtive exchange of glances, and I hastily added, I have no idea what they're planning, and as far as I know, they aren't planning to have the baby in London. I ended with my most convincing, but what would I know, shrug. So the fact that the baby would not be born in London, or Bolivia, or Zimbabwe, or Mars for that matter, was major news. Any tiny detail or non-detail is major news. And some journalists will come up with the most ingenious ways to uncover these tidbits, as illustrated below by the line of questioning I'm often subjected to. Whilst premiering the first episode of The Great Indian Home Makeover, a televised show on interior redecorating that I host. Question: tell us about the show. Answer: it's a home makeover show where we surprise a homeowner and make over one room in the space of 48 hours. Question: speaking of redecorating, how are you doing up the baby's room in Saifina's house? Whilst at a press conference for Balmain watches. Tell us what you like about Balmain watches. Well, they're stylish, elegant, and feminine. A woman's watch is more than just a timepiece. It's a piece of jewelry, a style accessory. Speaking of time, it's a happy time in the family with the baby coming. When is it due? Whilst at a store inauguration for a jewelry brand. What is your favorite piece of jewelry? Well, my engagement ring, for obvious reasons. Speaking of rings, you'll be ringing in the new year with a new family member. How will you all spend New Year's Eve? Whilst I was promoting my film, The 31st of October. Tell us about the film and your role in it. It's a real life story about the 1984 anti-Sikh riots, and I play a Sardarni. I have three children in the film. Speaking of children, okay, this one I forgive. Whilst at a Femina Diva style contest, what does style mean to you? Wearing your personality on your sleeve, being comfortable, confident, carrying yourself in a way, etc., etc. Speaking of standing out, isn't Kareena setting new fashion trends with her baby bump? During a lifestyle interview, where do you see yourself 5 years from now? I don't plan ahead much. I try not to live in the past or plan for the future. I live in the present. Speaking of presents, what are you going to give the baby? Have you decided? during a press conference to announce Kunal and my production company, Renegade Films. Why did you choose to name your company Renegade Films? Renegade means rebel. We liked that it stands for going against the grain, doing things differently. Speaking of names, is it true that they're naming the baby Sefina? You get the drift. I calculated that the damage done in this instance was minimal, and so I tossed my phone aside, took another sip of my coffee, and turned to the less alarming headlines of the national press. That's that. Thank you. And each one of those is 100% true.
So to put it mildly, Soha has suffered a lot. You know?
I have, but I'm very patient. That's, I think, where my patience comes from.
So, Soha, really, just give us, did you at all have to go through this process? We're laughing, we're doing all of this, but it can be pretty daunting, to really have people not see you at all, pretty much physically not see you, except in relation to who you are to other people.
Not seeing you would actually even be preferable sometimes, because then you're not recognized. I think what happens when you're in the middle is that, and I'll illustrate with just an example. When I go to the airport, which is often, you are recognized. So when you're standing in a queue, of course, to get in or to check in, people will recognize who you are, and then they'll come up to you and they'll want to take, of course, the selfies that we love. And everyone will take the selfies. So you're famous enough to be recognized, but you're not that famous that you can jump the queue and miss out on all of that. So then you're sort of like, somebody help me, but there's no one around to help you. So that tends to happen a lot. And often, you're recognized again and you feel quite happy, especially in England, where my friends from England are like, you've become this famous movie star now. And I'm like, yes, well, a little bit. And you'll walk down Oxford Street and, there'll be a group of girls who'll recognize you, and I'll feel, wow, here I can illustrate to my friends how cool and famous I am. And they say, they recognize you. And I'm like, yes. And someone will come up to me, for an autograph or something. And, they'll point to each other and say, don't you know who she is? Don't you know who she is? And I'll be like, yeah, well, And they'll say, she's Saif Ali Khan's sister.
That's
mortifying. Yeah, it really is. And I have to just sort of pretend to run away. As they call him, Saif Ali. Saif Ali Khan, Saif Ali Khan. Like, you changed my gender. He's often mistaken for a girl.
So at which point did you... Come on, at which point did you give up on the externalities and really figure, this is where my selfhood lies,
I think that you quickly develop a thick skin in and I think it's once everything becomes so public and, you quickly learn and you accept and I don't know, it's a survival instinct that you have. I mean, because you have to get on with things, you have to live and you have to, I really want to be happy. I choose to be happy. And I can choose to, let things upset you. You can choose, I really think that your moods are somewhat in your control, mostly, and there's a lot that you can do to lift yourself out of that. And I like to surround myself with things that make me happy. And also, I think that we all have our strengths. And if someone's strength is, their success in their chosen field, if someone's strength is, the fact that they're famous or powerful, I feel like I have my strengths within the family. And, given that I belong to this family of superstars, I think what gives me a lot of confidence is the fact that all of them, each one of them, including my father when he was alive, turned to me, and I was the youngest in the family, when they needed to sort out certain things. And they said that, you have a certain personality that, helps us. And I think at that point I understood that I also have something to offer and something to bring. And everybody does. So, I don't know if I'm answering your question, because you're answering the question, you're asking me again and again. I'm trying to come up with ingenious ways of answering it, but,
Well, so you've spoken of Saif, and clearly your parents gave you a great sense of security. Because why I'm asking it again and again is because the book is really quite, it does explore the many ways in which, others would have felt a slight, or like I've been using the word obliteration. So, but I get that you've come from a very affectionate family that's given you a great sense of security, superb. What about when Kareena entered your life, Did you have any sort of, I'm trying to phrase this in a delicate way, like really rage against her,
No, I'm trying to think of when I felt rage against her. Of course, you know, I've looked at her and said, wow, she has everything. I mean, and what is wonderful is, and what I've often thought, you know, often when we want to make ourselves feel better, you know, we look at actresses who are scaling the top of their charts and we say, they must be very unhappy, you know, because they must be. You have to make a choice. And I've always felt that if you're doing really well, then you've, you know, obviously there's no love in your life and there's no one to go home to, you know, and then you feel so much better about yourself. And I know for a fact in her case that she, and I'm not just saying that because, you know, I know who she's married to, but, she's managed to do that, which is to be professionally successful and personally successful. And I saw that in my mother's case as well. So again, I'm not able to answer your question to your satisfaction because I've obviously just, you know, I've just seen that in my life. So I know it's possible. I know, she's corrected that misunderstanding for me. And of course, you know, the things that, you know, I look at her and I say, wow, I've seen her first thing in the morning and I've just been like, she has amazing skin. So, I mean, these are things that I look at her and it's not rage, it's just, you know, it's just makes me do yoga because, you know, that's what I want to do because she does have flawless skin.
Yeah. So just, final question before we open this up to audience, but... you know, you said that in many ways you set out to write this book to correct misconceptions that people have had of you. So, you know, quite apart from them just talking of you as the sister or the brother or the, like me, son of. But what were the misconceptions that people had of you?
I think the main one was, being this sort of modern day princess and what life would be like. I wanted to clear that up. A lot of people also felt that you belong to this Nawab family, and I think that they felt, because the comment that I got, and I only understood this because after spending time with people, they'd say, oh, you're so down to earth. And I then would, you know, go home and think, oh, they must have had this impression of me that was different. And so I thought, you know, in a way where I'm not only taking myself very seriously, but I've sort of dared to not take things like my father very seriously as well, and talked a little bit about what it was actually like growing up in this Nawab family, where, for example, you know, there were yellow post-it notes stuck on every available surface saying, turn the lights off, you're not paying the electricity bill, I am. And I was sort of like, well, aren't we very rich? You know, is this a problem? Or I would say, can I go to Priyanka's house for dinner? And he'd say, no, the car has already been to Khan Market. I'm not sending the car again. And I'd be like, petrol is also very expensive. So he was very aware of, the value of money. And, you know, I mean, of course, being rich or poor is relative because, you know, I learned this because I talked about how my life has changed. And I can't imagine how much change my father saw. You know, because he lost so much in terms of, you know, not only becoming Mr. Khan from being the Nawab of Pataudi, losing his eye, losing his father. You know, there was a lot that he saw and took in his stride. But, myself moving from, you know, the sprawling 3-acre house in the middle of Delhi to what I have called my pokey 2-bedroom flat in Bombay, where, of course, someone said she thinks a 2-bedroom flat is small. And then I realized it's all relative, of course. And, of course, I've forgotten your question. What was your question? This also happens when you're not trained.
No, but you were on a good track, you know, which is to... there's some other really hilarious episodes about your father talking about what all Soha has suffered, of course, relative suffering, is also access to phones. You know, I think that's something you should share.
Oh, my God. I don't know. Maybe if them, because as some of you are presumably of his time. And I don't know whether this was like, you know, something that everyone did at that time. But, there was a landline, you know, and with a long extension cord that would go into various rooms. And, you know, I would try and find out where the room is and follow the wire. And it would ultimately be in my sister's room and she would have locked the door. And my father at some point decided that landline is going to be next to him. So he would sit, he would sit on his takht, and so I would remember him doing that and read every newspaper and every magazine. And the phone would be right there. And yet he would be infuriated by the sound of it ringing, as if it was disturbing whatever it was that he was doing. He hated phone conversations. When he got the mobile, he said, and you know, we would try and call him, it would always be switched off. And I said, Abba, what is the point of you having a mobile phone? And he said, well, it's to make other people available to me, not me available to other people. So I said, fair enough, which is wonderful. So he would always have it off. So And I would struggle with what to say to him in case he answered the phone, which of course he always did. So when I was in England, for example, I would actually write down conversation points to talk to my father about, because the conversation would end so fast. And more often than not, you know, he would answer the phone and I would say, "Adab, Abba," and he would say, "Who is it?" And I'd say, "Well, you know, you have two daughters who call you Abba. One is at home and one is in England." And then I'd say, "Well, it's Soha." And he'd say, "Your mother's not home." And I'd say, "Well, how are you?" "I'm fine." And I'd say, "Well, you know, I've struggled with what to talk about." He'd say, "Are you okay for money?" And I'd say, "Yes, yes, I am." Even, you know, even if I wasn't, I'd be like, "Yes, yes, I am. That's a conversation I'll have with my mother." And he'd say, "Well, I'll tell her you called," and click, before I could think of anything else to say. So it was very, I don't know. Maybe some of you can tell me what that's about.
And again, speaking about luxury and the lack of, there's another story which we'll end on, which is really a wonderful one, which is about Mansoor Ali Khan Pataudi and socks, you know, so.
Yes, it is one of my favorite stories because, you know, he was very proud of me when I went to Balliol, which was the college that he went to and the college that his father went to as well. And he was, you know, he enjoyed that part of tradition. And when we graduated, they're very strict about their sub-fusc and the outfit that you have to wear. When you go for your exams, you know, you have to wear the full gear and carry your mortarboard. You're not allowed to wear it, of course, until you graduate, but you must have it. And you have to wear a different color flower in your buttonhole, depending on what exam, as if you're not stressed enough about your exams. You're like, "No, today is a pink flower, today is a white flower, today is a red flower." So they're very strict on all of that. And when you graduate again, you have to wear all of that, and you know, women have to wear dark stockings or socks with their court shoes. And I've of course forgotten, and I was wearing a sari, and I was sort of bare feet under my sari, and I was wearing my shoes. I wasn't wearing stockings, and they weren't going to allow me to graduate. And I thought, how can this be? And my father actually took off his shoes, took off his big woolly socks, and gave them to me. And so I wore my, and if you look closely at my graduation picture, I'm wearing these sort of lovely stilettos and these big woolen socks. And if you knew my father, he would never have taken off his socks for any other college. And I like to joke and say, and I said that, you know, well, you know, my brother inherited this empty title of being the Nawab Pataudi after my father passed away. And I said, "Well, I may never know what it's like to walk in my father's shoes, but I do know what it's like to walk in his socks."
Yes. So, you know, Payal's been trying to ring the bell from the side, so I'm going to be obedient this time. Let's open this up for questions. Yeah. You can't possibly be obliterating Soha like this with no questions. Yes. And after all that laughing, surely, you know.
No, it was also, I was very nervous when I came here because, you know, it's a tough act to follow, Ashishda. And I was very nervous. I came here and I was listening to you. And on the way here, I was watching it on the live chat where I noticed we're wearing very similar clothes. And I thought, oh, shall I go home and change? Anyway, I want to.
Sorry, there was a question there.
It's, yeah. Uma Mashi to the rescue.
Yes. No, not to the rescue. Soha, so are you going to start writing now?
Am I going to start?
Yeah, I mean, going to write a few more books.
You know, I quite enjoyed the process. I thought it would be difficult. I think I would like to write more, but if there was anything I was going to write now, it would be on the perils of parenting, because that's all I'm thinking about. But yes, I think I would
like
to. The
same humor, I'm sure.
Yes, I would like to think that I never stepped away. You know, I'm asked this question all the time as well, is that, you know, why don't we see you enough on the screen?
So because you're not going there to see me.
I know, yes, that's true. I'm quite sure you haven't seen my last three films. But I have done a little bit, you know, a role in Sahib Bibi Gangster. I was in the second part, a wonderful film directed by Tigmanshu Dhulia. And then I was quite convinced they were going to bump me off in the third part because I was heavily pregnant. But I went to see him and I've convinced him to keep me on. So without giving away too much of the plot, I think I might be in a coma in the third part. Come back in the fourth. thank you so much for saying that. Thank you.
I really look forward to seeing another film.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And are the cousins close? The Safina baby and yours?
I don't think they're old enough to. Physically, we brought them quite close. You know. In fact, too close, because then Temur started pulling at Inaya.
Are you close to Temur?
I'm
close to Temur.
Of course I am. I'm very close to Temur. I'd like to get closer. And I do want the two of them to be close.
Yeah. So I think you are funny bones. Right. The title belongs elsewhere.
Now
this this is yet.
You know, I really like my heart goes out. So I'm so sorry.
This is like ending on a Simi Grewal note.
No, this was a fun session. Really enjoyed it.
Thank you.
You have to come up with a new name. Now you can't transport her into Twinkle Khanna's body, you know.
Creativity is not my strength. I'll leave it to you. Just on a more serious note, what do you think of this whole issue about nepotism in the industry? Because I know it's been asked to Karan Johar, and everybody laughed it away and said that if a doctor's son can be a doctor, engineer's son can be an engineer, why can't we? So, but it's a tad unfair, isn't it? Because it's like a club which is very hard to enter. And some people can enter and exit.
No, of course. But I think that nepotism is not unique to the film industry. I won't deny that it's a fact of life that if you have contacts and if you have, you know, whether they're in your family or outside of your family, it might make meetings and appointments easier. People will answer your phone. But I find that it confuses the issue for me because people are very polite, but it just takes longer for them to say no, you know. And I'd rather they just say no in the beginning.
Well, you know, this really kind of sums up Soha, that what's delightful, and I think her real riposte to the world, is this little passage in the book where she's describing Bollywood's self-obsession, and she has this really, truly wonderful three pages on Mercator's maps and how he was this German cartographer who basically thought he was the center of the world and Germany was the center of the world. And so the entire world map is really distended and the your entire sense of proportion is wrong because he imagined that he and Germany was the center of the world. And that's the analogy she draws for her Bollywood fraternity, you know? So I think that is the riposte. That's the Soha. We've got a glimpse of it here, but there is the brain that got her to get a history degree in Oxford. Balliol College, and she also was irritated enough to tell an aunt that she was going to Balliol College without the the suffix of Oxford. So the aunt just ruffled her hair and said, "Oh, poor you," you know, not realizing that she was headed to the great, great university that her father had been to as well. So, ladies and gentlemen, as we said, this really was about that inexplicable thing, which is the self, and what we privilege to make ourselves comfortable with ourselves. You've got a glimpse into one person and how she's done it in the midst of, really, as I said earlier, a blizzard of what could have been obliteration, but she did not allow it to become that. So salute for that, Soha, and thanks so much for sharing your journey
with us. Thank you so much, Soha. Thank you.